Guy Miles leaving prison in 2017 after 18 years and 10 months for a crime he did not commit. And the lawyer by his side on that ride home was Justin Brooks.
Justin is right here. He's right here.
He's not lying. We're heading home and this nightmare is over.
The case of the wrongfully convicted Guy Miles in Orange County, just one of thousands of people serving time in America for crimes they did not commit. Justin Brooks has made it his mission in life to free as many of them as he can.
Brian Banks was 16 years old when he was accused of a crime he did not commit. He lost 11 years. Scholarship. He was prevented from playing football.
The system is broken.
We have 10 months to clear his name.
If in that time...
The actor Greg Kinnear portrayed him in the Brian Banks story about the top-rated USC and NFL-bound linebacker Brian Banks, who was also wrongfully convicted of a crime, ultimately freed thanks to Justin Brooks and the California Innocence Project. Why and how is it that you might go to prison even though you're innocent? That's the title of a new book, and its author is Justin Brooks. I am honored to once again have Justin Brooks with us on Frank Buckley Interviews. Welcome back.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be back.
And thank you for what you do, Justin. I want to follow up with you about Brian Banks and learn more about Guy Miles and his case in a moment. But first, I wanted to get a sense of where things stand right now when it comes to the number of people who are in prison, who shouldn't be, who didn't commit the crimes for which they stand. You say in your book that thousands of innocent people have been freed from prison, largely due to DNA evidence, which can now often prove their innocence. But you say those cases are just the tip of the iceberg. Is there a way to quantify the number of folks who are in this position?
I mean, anyone who throws a specific number out is, you know, really making it up. Mm. Because there's no way to know the exact number, and I'll tell you why. There's certain cases that even if the person's innocent, it's basically impossible to prove it once they've been convicted. So for example, I've never won a drug case. I've never been able to reverse that conviction in a drug case. And it's possible that you have three or four people in a car and one person has cocaine on them and the police search the car. Technically, they could all be charged with possession, but some people in the car may not have known the drugs were there. Mm-hmm. But if a jury didn't believe that at trial, there's nothing I can do later. So the reason you see so many homicide and rape cases reversed is because those involve forensic evidence, mm. and you can use science to reverse those cases. So DNA kind of led the way 20, 30 years ago to opening the door to wrongful convictions, but now we know there's many, many more where there's just not that kind of scientific evidence that can prove innocence.
I remember the last time we talked, you said that Governor Newsom was very difficult to convince and was not necessarily a fan or an ally in this work. Mm-hmm. You said Kamala Harris was often an obstacle. Has that changed in terms of Governor Newsom, and has the new AG Rob Bonta had a different approach to this?
It's certainly changed in terms of Governor Newsom. We've had clemency granted now to several of our clients mm. after his office have reviewed them, and we've had more clemencies coming from him than any of the prior governors. In terms of Kamala Harris, she's in Washington, D.C. yeah. now doing other things,
right.
but she was not particularly helpful in terms of our litigating compensation claims. The current attorney general doesn't get involved now in compensation claims because we actually got the law changed to get the attorney general out of the process. Mm. Because what would happen would be a judge would find someone innocent, and then we'd have to go through a whole second process of litigating the case against the attorney general that would often take a position against it, even after the judge who'd heard all the evidence, heard all the witnesses, declared the person innocent. So the new procedure is if you are found to be innocent in a court in California, it gets automatic compensation of $150 a day for every day you're wrongfully incarcerated.
Which obviously doesn't even begin to compensate someone No. for the loss of their lives. I mean, in the case of Guy Miles, we talked about 18 years and 10 months of his life for a crime he did not convict. It's not like you just got him off. He didn't commit the crime.
Right. He wasn't even in the state of California when the crime happened. He was in Nevada, and there were 10 witnesses that put him there. And Guy Miles was a victim of bad identifications, which is one of the things I spend a lot of time talking about in my new book. And the chapter in that book is called You Look Like Other People in the World.
Right.
Because the whole idea of the book is that anyone can be wrongfully convicted.
Yeah.
And maybe you look like somebody, and that's enough that at some point you could be in an identification procedure. And in his case, it was a cross-racial identification, which we found are the worst types of identifications.
Where you have a white person identifying a black person or vice versa or
exactly.
some other race.
And jurors, you know, lawyers don't do a good enough job of explaining that to juries. And I think there's just a discomfort talking about race in general in our society.
Yeah.
But it has nothing to do with racism. It has to do with exposure. Mm. And it has to do with, as a child, you develop your facial recognition software kind of in the first 4 years of your life. So if mom is white and dad is white and the brothers and sisters are white and you're not exposed to other races, for the rest of your life, you will not be as good at identifying those races as people of that race.
And in the case of someone like Guy Miles, he is freed from prison after 18 years and 10 months. Mm-hmm. Yes, he gets financial compensation. What happens next to someone who has been through this terrible injustice?
Yeah. I've gone through this journey now so many times with my clients, you know, 38 times, and I talk to them before they're getting released about what it's going to be like. And typically it's something like, well, nobody cared about your case for 20 years. For the next 48 hours, everybody's going to care about it. Everyone's going to want to talk to you. And then those people are going to start disappearing again. Mm-hmm. And you're going to have to pick up the pieces and get your life back together. So they always have this initial elation and excitement, and we see it on TV with their hands in the air and cheering. But then it starts sinking into them of how much they lost, of how difficult it is to reintegrate into their families and their old relationships. And they didn't just lose time. They were tortured during that period of time. Mm. And that's psychologically damaging. They have difficulty making choices. They struggle with anything to do with technology because the world changes.
Yeah. The last time we were here was 2018, 2019, and we were just to get back to the identification process. Mm-hmm. In the case of Guy, people misidentified, and he was convicted on that. You told me during your last visit that in L.A. County, for example, there were archaic procedures, as you described them, for identifying potential suspect.
Yep.
Have those procedures changed?
So good news is, after decades of trying to get LA to change their procedures, they were finally forced to by legislation. Mm. It was terrible that Los Angeles, the largest county in the United States, was not following the science that had been proven definitively that things like six-pack photo arrays don't work.
Mm.
And now they can't use those anymore. The procedures have to be double blind, meaning the officer who knows who the suspect is can't be in the room during the identification process.
Because he or she might sort of indicate in some nonverbal way that that's the suspect.
They're terrible poker players. Mm. I mean, even professional poker players wear hats and sunglasses and scarves. And the thing I actually see more often than them sort of indicating is the witness will say something like, well, kind of looks like number three. And then the officer will say, oh, good. Mm. Okay, great. And that affirmation, by the time they get to trial, they're saying, I'm 100% sure it's that guy.
Right.
And they were never 100% sure, but the jury never sees that.
Yeah.
They don't see the initial identification procedure.
And so what happens now?
So now they're supposed to be recording those procedures. You can't have the officers involved in the process who know who the suspect is. They've got to be double blind. They're not using six-pack photo arrays. They have to show photos one at a time, and that makes it less suggestive. They can't be saying things to them like, we arrested a guy and we've got him in custody, now we want you to do an ID. Because then you're thinking, oh, it's definitely one of these guys. And
right.
then you just pick whoever looks most like the person in your head. So these reforms have been around a very long time, and finally Los Angeles is following them.
Do you believe as a result of a reform like that fewer innocent people are being convicted?
100%. And I also believe more guilty people will be found.
Mm.
That's what's always frustrated me about that reform, is it's not some defense attorney reform. It's like, if we do this in a better way, you'll get better IDs, you'll get more bad guys, and fewer good guys will end up getting wrongfully identified.
And just quickly on Brian Banks, this young man who had such a promising future in football, university, many people thought he would become a pro player. How is he doing now?
He's doing great. He's doing a lot of speaking engagements. He's a very inspirational speaker. He's put his life back together, but it was a journey for him as well. You know, he got back to playing football for a period of time for the Falcons, and now he's adjusting to regular life.
That is wonderful to hear. All right, we're going to take a short break. Recently, two podcasters unearthed evidence that was used to help free two wrongfully convicted men in Georgia from prison. I want to ask Justin about the rise of true crime podcasters and how or if that's changing the work he does. A dramatic homecoming of two Georgia men who were locked away for 25 years, wrongfully convicted of murder. They were released after the Proof podcast unearthed evidence proving their innocence. I'm joined again by the director of the California Innocence Project, Justin Brooks, discussing his new book, You Might Go to Prison, Even Though You're Innocent. This rise of true crime podcasts, is it helpful to you or is it distracting from the work you do?
Oh, I think it's 100% helpful. I'm a huge fan. Because even if it doesn't help us exonerate people and it has limited purpose and the number of people who are going to get exonerated directly from a podcast, it gets people thinking about the topic. And when they serve as jurors, they're going to look closer at evidence. When they're looking to elect judges and elect politicians, they might think a little bit about, you know, should we just be electing people who say they're tough on crime? Mm. Or do we want people who are actually making reforms within the criminal justice system? So I'm a huge fan of the whole podcast movement, the series on, you know, Netflix series, all the things that go out there in terms of wrongful convictions.
You mentioned LA County and the reforms that have been made here. We have a district attorney, George Gascon, who has taken a lot of criticism from people within his own office, from law enforcement, from victims' rights groups. Mm-hmm. From your point of view as someone who is helping the wrongfully convicted, has he helped to make reforms in that area at all?
Oh, absolutely. I think now the conviction review unit that he has in his office really works hard to find cases where people have been wrongfully convicted instead of taking the position, a defensive position of trying to defend those convictions. We've seen these offices or these units within offices open up around the country, and some of them are just basically publicity stunts to say, we're reviewing these cases and checking them out. And then when you look at their criteria for reviewing cases, they'll say, well, we won't look at a case where there's a plea. We won't look at a case where there's a confession. We won't look at a case where there's an ID. And then they're just not looking at any cases.
Right.
So I think Los Angeles is doing a legitimate inspection of their old cases, and when they're finding, they're coming forward and agreeing that they should be exonerated.
Help people to understand who might have a misconception about what you do, who might think this guy is getting people off who are obviously criminals in some way, otherwise they would never get pulled into a dragnet like this. Mm-hmm. So if they get convicted of something else, well, they were probably bad people to begin with. To that, right. You say what?
Well, that's why I wrote this book. That's exactly why I wrote it. It used to be that people didn't believe that people were wrongfully convicted. That's when I started my career, that was the argument I had. Well, now that we have more than 3,000 documented cases of wrongful conviction.
3,000?
Yeah, there's more than 3,000. And so people can't deny any longer that. But now we're into this sort of psychological defensive period of, well, it happens to people, but it kind of happens to bad people, or it happens to people who've done other things, or certainly it doesn't wouldn't happen to me. And that's the stories in this book. I talk about how there's been lots of middle-class people in middle America going on with their lives, and then one day they just get arrested.
Like, it's Kafka.
Yeah.
Right? It's the trial.
It is a Kafka nightmare
that
they find themselves in. And that's why each chapter of the book, I look at a different kind of cause of wrongful conviction, but from a very practical way. Like, for instance, I talk about that in rural areas. If you live in rural areas, I've seen a lot of wrongful convictions because the police don't have the capacity to do crime scene investigations. And in inner city areas, you see people getting wrongfully convicted due to over-policing. And we talked already that sometimes you might just look like somebody and then you get picked up. You're in the wrong place in the wrong time. we now know definitively, and I'll tell you how definitive it is for me. I literally have a plan that if I ever get wrongfully convicted.
Well, let's go through it. Let's say someone says, you're a bad guy. Six people identify, Justin Brooks, that must be this guy. You're convicted. What happens?
So I think, first of all, I wouldn't make some of the mistakes in my book. Like, I'd be able to find a good lawyer.
Right.
And I think a lot of people go to prison because they haven't had good lawyering. I think I probably have a better chance based on race issues as I enter the system and bias and perception. But if I do end up being wrongfully convicted, I literally have in my head that the first day of prison, I'm going out on the yard, I'm going to find all the shot callers, I'm going to say, I'm going to be your lawyer and your lawyer and your lawyer. I'll be in the law library every day working on your case.
Right.
Keep the rest of these guys off me.
Yeah, yeah.
And anyone who does this work thinks like that.
Right.
Because we've seen it happen so many times that just regular people not committing crimes, going on with their lives, can get wrongfully convicted.
And is there anything I can do to prevent myself from getting into that position? I.e., I know one of the things I've told my kids is, God forbid you're ever arrested, as much as you want to tell the officers everything, I'm innocent, sure, I'll go to the interview room and sit down for 24 hours and talk to you about the story. You don't. You say, I want to see a lawyer, and then you get the story out through your lawyer. Is there anything else that you do?
That's great advice to start with. Yeah. I mean, the only thing talking to the police can accomplish for you is convenience. That maybe you'll be leaving quicker if you can explain a story.
Right.
But you also might be spending the rest of your life in prison. So you might leave quickly, or you might spend the rest of your life in prison, whereas the route of not saying anything has more of a chance that you're going to have a minor inconvenience.
And by the way, that's if you're arrested. I'm not saying if an officer comes up to you and say, did you witness something, you don't say anything. Mm-hmm. Help cooperate with the police. But if someone is accusing you of a crime or suggesting you're involved, it's best to have an attorney present.
Although the difficulty sometimes is knowing if you're a suspect or you're being accused. I mean, we see in these baby death cases where parents bring their children to the hospital and there's been an accident, and the parents always say things that end up being twisted into being incriminating. Mm. You know, you're a father. If your child got injured in your care, you would feel responsible.
Yeah.
And so they say, I feel responsible. They say, I feel guilty. Mm. Next thing they're writing down, parents said they're guilty. Mm. And we've seen a lot of these baby death cases that were misdiagnosed, and they're some of the most tragic cases.
Yeah. What can we do as a society to reduce this? We don't want people who didn't commit a crime going to prison. What can we do?
Well, first of all, we need to recognize it. We need to do things like reviewing old cases. We need to do things like reforming police procedures. Every interrogation should be recorded by every police officer in the United States of America. If a jury could assess what the person said in the context of what it was said, it'd be a very different outcome. But we also need to free up resources in the system to do a better job. And we've done far too many increases in sentences over the last 30 years. And now we have the biggest prison system in the world. We incarcerate the highest percentage of our population in the world. So we're spending billions and billions of dollars. So we have to figure out a way to cut that down to provide more resources to the system to do a better job.
All right. One more short break. When we come back, I'm going to ask Justin if there's a case of a wrongfully convicted person in prison right now that keeps him up at night. And we're back with Justin Brooks. He's the director of the California Innocence Project, author of the new book, You Might Go to Prison Even Though You're Innocent. And the last time you were with me, I asked you how you slept at night. You said you've had 30 years of nightmares. And I just wonder if you're sleeping any better, or is there a case that keeps you up at night?
No, I don't think I'm sleeping any better. I was speaking at a high school recently, and a 16-year-old kid said to me, how do you figure out your work-life balance? And I just sort of stared at him, and I got really choked up, and I was like, I don't.
Yeah.
I don't have a good work-life balance.
Yeah.
This work never goes away. And, you know, I tell young lawyers, if you want a life like this, a 9-to-5, do not do this.
Yeah.
Because this work has incredible highs. The days we get our clients out of prison, and incredible lows with the days we lose cases, where we can't convince a judge what we know is true, that the person's innocent. And for 27 years, one particular case kept me up every night, and that was Marilyn Malero. And I started that case when I was 29 years old. She was on death row. It was my first innocence case. I was able to get her off death row. But then for the next 25 years after that, I litigated to withdraw her guilty plea and prove her innocence in court. And I finally finished that case this past October.
Oh.
So I started the case when I was 29 years old. I finished it at 57. And when it was finally over, I literally couldn't speak. I was sort of just at a loss. It was almost, I'd carried that case for so long that I almost didn't know who I was if I wasn't representing her. So that one had blotted out, but there's so many. There's current cases we have now that are tragic. You know, when I go visit the clients in prison, that then burns it into my brain that it's a human being with family members that's suffering every day, that we can't do anything about it. So yeah, there's a lot of them in my head.
In the 45 seconds we have left, is there one thing that I can do as a citizen that helps you to help the people who should not be in prison to get out?
Well, first of all, serve on jury duty when you're called. Really look closely at politicians who are running for office about what their policy really is, because these tough on crime policies without any real substance behind them have got us into a really bad place. And, you know, support the work of innocence organizations. The California Innocence Project can always use your help. And you can find us at californiainnocenceproject.org.
All right. Justin, thank you much so much for being with us and for another very important book.
Thank you.
All right. And thank you for joining us. Don't forget that you can catch all of our interviews, our conversations on Frank Buckley Interviews as an audio podcast. You can also see any of our programs on YouTube or on the KTLA Plus app. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.